Thanks for joining. Sorry for the minor delay, technical issues, but it looks like it's solved. So let's start. I will speak about package stores today. I will first start with this, getting rid of this. I'm Pierre Pronchery. I'm an Earthling. I've been working on operating system development since 2004 on a pet project of mine that I'm still working on. I have the ambition of writing an operating system on my own, but of course it's a daunting task, but doing this, I learned a lot. And while doing so, I got into NetBSD as an excellent way to learn how to write an operating system. It's a great reference. And I eventually became a developer since May 2012. What I like to do with NetBSD is use Git to work on it, which is not the official way. So I started the HPSD project in August 2013. I've presented it in the past few years, and we're still working on this, using this infrastructure to share our patches and allow peer review more easily than on a regular CVS repository. And professionally, I'm currently involved with a company called Diffora Networks. You know where the name comes from. And I started this with a friend in 2016, and we do pen testing and trainings. So now for what really matters for us today. If you don't know about package stores, it's the right place to be, PSDcan, because package stores is actually the way that we ship third-party software on NetBSD. So it's technically a software distribution, but it also includes a build framework and a package manager. It's the default source for package software, not only on NetBSD, but also on SmartOS, on Minix, and a few other platforms. We actually support a lot more. So over 17,000 packages that are now listed in the tree can be built for the most part and used on over 17 different platforms. But today we'll focus on a very specific aspect of package stores and software management, security. I am working on security myself because this concerns me a lot, privacy and every other aspect. It's a hostile world out there. Maybe we have here a very nice open community, but some people are also working on the other side. Here we do defense, but offense is also very lucrative and a lot of fun. The media calls it cyber. I know I said it, but yeah. What it comes down to is that as a software vendor, we have a responsibility towards our users. Our users rely on us to provide a safe platform as much as we can. And this is therefore something that package stores should concern itself with. So I tried in this talk to gather a number of mechanisms that can be already used to further strengthen the security of package stores. And I will provide also a few ways that we can investigate to continue on this path. But first and foremost, I will start with the process. We have a security management process in package stores. We have two teams working on this. I will explain their roles in a second. And of course, at the end of the presentation, I will take questions. But if you feel like any time, just interrupt me and I will try to answer in context. All right, so I just mentioned we have two teams, part of package stores dealing with security. One is called security team, so it's core focus. And the other team that also has to do with security is the release engineering group. Part of the security management process, we also have the vulnerability database, which is really essential to managing security with package stores. And it allows us to audit the system, among other things. And also, very importantly, we have stable releases, of course, and they are maintained for security vulnerabilities. We provide patches and binaries. There are even possibilities to get long-term support. I will briefly explain how this works. So the security team itself has two main duties. They handle security issues relevant to package stores. So they will receive, of course, the bug reports, which are flagged for security. But you can also contact them directly confidentially, thanks to a PGP key. The address is here. And the security team is in charge of maintaining the vulnerability database. So what does this consist in? It's assembled from, of course, logs and release notes from upstream packages when they are aware of security issues and release a new version. They hopefully mention it in the release notes, and then we can react a bit faster and actually list this inside the vulnerability database. Of course, there are security vendors like Secunia, which provide us with advisories that we can reflect in our database. There are also general purpose mailing lists like OSS Security, on which security vulnerabilities are discussed. We also take input from there. And of course, there are plenty of organizations like Mitre or different certs, which also deal with this on a daily basis. And we get information from every source we can find. The vulnerability database is, of course, signed with PGP. And you can use it in your system. There is already a mechanism in place in NetPSD at least to obtain this database daily, to refresh it daily. It's not on by default, although there will be a warning. And the warning consists in, it advises you to add this line to etc.daily.conf, and then the system will every day fetch the vulnerability database. You can also fetch it manually. This is the command with package admin that's used by the system when this mechanism is enabled. And to trigger a audit manually, you will use also the package admin command with the audit subcommand. It will then give you a list of vulnerabilities that are known on your system. However, package source is initially meant for being used as a source tree to build from source, although it's not the only way. So if you build from source and you have the vulnerability database installed on your system, right when it will, when package source will try to install, actually begin to build the system, the package, sorry, it will check the database for vulnerabilities and you will get something like this. So if you try to install a vulnerable version of the Xen kernel, if you try to build it, then package source will actually refuse if there is a known vulnerability and you didn't set anything in your configuration. Like here, the allow vulnerable packages variable in make.conf. Now, if you prefer to deal with binaries, which I do actually personally, and you try to install, say, a vulnerable version of Wireshark, like 2.2.1, there is a known vulnerability, actually plenty more for this version by now. And by default, the installation will simply fail and will let you know why. Actually even giving you the reference to the vulnerabilities where you can get more information about it. So how to deal with that? Of course, you can override this check. By default, the system will always check for vulnerabilities, but you can also opt to being prompted about installing known vulnerable packages. This is how you can do it. You set interactive instead of always in packageinstall.conf, and then you will be prompted every time. Yeah.
Is check vulnerabilities always default?
The default is always, yes.
So you don't need the line.
Sorry, again?
The line, the file can be omitted.
Yeah, exactly. By default, it will behave like this. You don't need to configure anything, and you will not be able to install anything that's known to be vulnerable. But for this to work, the database has to be there, and it's not installed right away when you start the system. So you would like to have
package order does what it needs to do, and then when I go to do a package install, the stuff it needs to do in the order and all the rest is there. Because package download is really long string. I can't remember that. Anyway, let me keep going. It's a suggestion.
Right. Well, I agree that all of these settings are non-trivial. However, of course, they are documented in manual page. There is one issue in that if you do not have the vulnerability database configured yet or downloaded yet, which is the case on a fresh system, you will not get any of these prompts until it actually happens. However, I think every day you should get a daily email about the status of the system, and it will tell you about how to get started with this. It will tell you you have to choose if you want to get daily updates or not, and then you can either configure that to no and it will stop nagging you about it, or you can enable it, and then this will always show up. And the default is to prevent installation of known vulnerabilities. So I think the balance is, I think the balance is quite all right, except for the fact that on a fresh system, you will not have the database yet. So you may, in that window, install vulnerable packages. I do not know right away how to solve that, but it could be something we can think of in NetPSD. Of course, this is more relevant for NetPSD than other systems on which packet source works, since that's integrated with the base system. And if you use packet source on other systems, it will not be as tightly integrated. So it will be up to the user of packet source to actually do all of this, because you will get no daily status updates and so on. But I hope this answers your question for now. All right, perfect. So I will take this moment to thank the security team members who are taking care of this. Alistair, Daniel, Seven, Thomas, Tobias, Rio, Frederick, Jörg, and Tim. So thanks everyone. And with this done, I will move on to the release engineering group, which has essentially three duties that I could list here. It manages stable branches. They process pull-up requests to implement fixes that have been known after branching on the stable branches. This includes security issues. It's the main focus, actually. And then the release engineering group also schedules freeze periods, because packet source has a quarterly release cycle. Like every 3 months, we try to come up with a stable release, and this team is in charge of that. So you can know if there is a release that's being prepared using this address at the bottom, is a freeze on, which is very helpful for developers to stop committing big changes. This is a regular procedure of the packet source project. So if you look at the current list of pull-up requests, I did this screenshot a couple days ago. There are quite a few requests to look at. I did not bother to scroll further down that list, but it's not so crazy. I did a few requests myself a couple days ago, but usually this list is very short. And here this has been going for about a month, so I guess it's in feedback. Yeah, no, probably not too important. Anyway, so as I said, we have quarterly releases. So if you want to know what the current status is about, the 2016 Q4 is no longer maintained. The current stable release is 17 Q1. So that's what you want to use if you want security fixes. And we are currently working on, therefore, 17 Q2, which is, if you want to use that, you can use directly ahead from CVS. Track the main branch, and this is what's going to be 17Q2. Then NetBSD and Packet Source itself is not the only provider of releases, stable releases of Packet Source. Joyent also provides long-term support on select branches of Packet Source. They usually choose the last release for a given year. And you can find them on GitHub. They focus on SmartOS, it's their core business. However, they also provide binaries for macOS X, I believe. And it can be also a way for you to track at least packet source on a source level and then build your own packages with security updates over the years if you want to stick with a given release. So I will just the same thank the members of the Release Engineering group here. So some of them are actually also part of the security team, but we have Rio, Frederick, Eric, Benny, and Petra, which are in this group. So thanks everybody. And with this done, the security process, I will move on to the more technical part of this talk. The hardening features. What we already have now in packet source is listed here. I'm going to go through these five different items. And the first will be package signatures. Ironically, PacketSource is one of the first software distribution to have included support for package signatures from the different open source projects, since we have this since 2001, based on X509 certificates or GNOPG. So you can use either your company's PKI or Web of Trust to sign your packages. Unfortunately, this was not enabled by default. It's still not the case. And there were a few bugs which made it not really usable, actually, until about 3-4 years ago when I started to look at this again. Again, I would like to remind everyone also that signing packages doesn't bring any fixes, doesn't help with finding vulnerabilities or mitigate any flaws. What it does is allow you to be sure that what you download is actually what's originally intended to be provided to you. So it makes sure you can authenticate the packages and that they are transferred as they should be. So Joyent, however, has enabled, is now using signatures on their packages since 2014 Q4. They're not using GNOPG anymore for verifying signatures. They use lib.pgp verify. I will get to this in a second. So in package source, we still rely on GNOPG right now to generate signed packages, which is an issue because GNOPG comes as a package. It's not available in base. So right now we cannot sign, I mean, we cannot verify the signature of the software which is going to sign the signatures. It needs to be installed as a package first. And that's a chicken and egg problem that I'm trying to work on at the moment. By switching to NetPGP, since on NetBSD in the base system we have a tool which can handle GPG signatures, either create signatures, sign, or verify signatures. It's called NetPGP, written by Alistair from different sources. And the first thing that I did, which I was hoping would be enough, was a command line wrapper to wrap what's expected by GNOPG to what NetPGP expects on the command line to work and behave the same way. This still requires some patches to actually work. The wrapper itself is good enough, but I had to make changes to NetPGP. I could commit most of them. However, Alistair pushed a new release, and I have to check if his changes or if he merged my patches in his new release. So I will have to take care of this, hopefully before NetBSD 8 is released. And I have to mention that there is still a security issue in NetPGP, which is relevant for checking signed packages in package source, because there is currently no way on the command line to make sure that it will look at detached signatures and only detached signatures. So right now, if you embed a file inside the signature, NetPGP will happily check the signature against this file, and then you can put anything else in a package, and it will just work and claim that it is verified. So I need to fix that, and this will involve the change either on the command line or switching to maybe using the library for NetPGP. So right now we stick to GNOPG to create signed packages. It's actually not too complicated. You have to set signed packages with GNOPG in make.conf. Then optionally you can set an alternate path to GNOPG, like using the wrapper here, which I commented out. And you can also force a specific key ID to be used. Then you can simply use package source from source, as you would regularly do, make install, make package, and so on, and it will just work as it should be normally. The only other thing you have to do is to import the keys, of course, for the user installing the packages so that they can be verified. Typically, if you install packages with your root user, you need to do it as root. Other than that, you only need the private key for the user actually building the packages, and the public key for the user verifying the packages, of course. Then I do not remember what the default is, but you can enforce packages to be verified upon installation always. I guess the default is to not check signatures, since right now we don't use them as a whole, as a project. But as you can see, if you install a package as usual, it will let you know explicitly at the moment that the signature is valid or not, was verified or not. So here I was using a test test output from the HPSD infrastructure to write this slide. And this is an example of a successful installation verification of a signature for a package. So unless there are any questions about this part, I'm going to continue with SSP, which this time is a mitigation for potential security issues. It will try to avoid silent corruption and potentially, therefore, exploits to work by crashing as soon as memory corruption is detected. Detection, however, is not always instant. So the way it works is that with this setting on, the compiler will reorganize the stack to use a different layout so that buffer overflows will affect directly the metadata on the stack and hopefully overwrite what's called the canary value. And then upon return of this function, the canary value is checked by the parent function. And if it's found to be changed, a memory corruption is assumed and the program aborts. So there is a slight performance penalty to this. However, it's really minor. And what you get is an instant crash instead of potentially ruining your memory or being exploited. So in package source, I have added a global flag to enforce this when compiling every package. It's package source use SSP for make.conf. So if you set it to yes, this will be used. If you are using package source either on Linux or FreeBSD on x86 or on NetBSD everywhere supported, which is every architecture except like 4, I think. So in practice, if you're using GCC and Clang, this will set the fstack protector flag when compiling, and this will implement it through the C flags. So this requires the underlying package to actually support C flags, which is not always the case, unfortunately. For GNU autoconf, it's usually always supported. We have a framework for that. However, for other build systems, it may not always use this, use the C flags from package source directly, which is a bug, actually. It's something that we want to work across all of the base of packages. Obviously, I mentioned GCC and Clang because this only protects C, C++ programs and interpreters. It will not magically protect your Python code. It would protect the interpreter, though. And also, just-in-time compilation will not be protected by this mechanism, since code is generated on the fly by the running program, and you cannot control from compile time how the program will actually generate and handle its own stack when it generates its own instructions. However, there is a way to further harden SSP support by extending it to every function and not just the default, which is whatever GCC feels like may be vulnerable. So in package source, if you don't put yes in this configuration variable value over here, but all, it will actually use stack protector all instead. And there is even support for a patch from Google, which is not in main GCC, but which Google wrote a patch to add another switch, another way to handle SSP, which is called strong. And so if you set strong in package source, you will try to use this instead. Of course, I would like to add support for more compilers and platforms which support that in package source, which is usually not too much work. You just have to know that this is supported, this is the flag that has to be used, and then it's just a couple lines in the package source framework. So an important thing of security is always to validate what you're doing, especially since we're not sure that every package will actually look at the C flags. So one way you can use on NetBSD at least with GCC to make sure that SSP is in place for a given program, at least for part of the code, is to check the list of symbols, like with NM. And if your program contains calls to stack check fail or stack check guard, it will be protected with SSP, or it should be. One more mention, which is a rant in disguise a bit. So this has been enabled by default in OpenBSD since 2003. I think it was called Propolis in OpenBSD. Fedora and Ubuntu Linux followed suit in 2006. Dragonfly BSD also, but in NetBSD, this is still not the default. It's supported in the base system, but I don't think it's the default in the base system. Yes, it is the default in the base system, sorry, but not in package source. So now we can, we could. It's just a matter of changing a flag in the defaults. And of course, I would like this to happen, even if this is not the best way to mitigate every security issue. I think it would bring something, and we even have it in base, so why not in packages? So now for a similar mechanism to SSP, a companion of sorts, there is Fortify, which works a lot in the same way. It mitigates some buffer overflows. It involves support from the libc, with SSP was more the compiler. But this also requires specific support from the compiler. So typically, it's implemented with GCC. I'm not sure about Clang. Here, the performance impact is actually negligible. I would even say there is no real performance impact. What it does is, when compiling a program, it will change calls on the fly. If your program calls, say, sprintf or string ncat or mmove and so on, the compiler will be directed to use different calls instead, and carrying with that information about the target buffer when it has it. So if it's a static buffer, the compiler knows how big it is. Then it will call instead sprintf check, for instance, with an additional size for the target buffer. And then if the buffer is overridden, the program will simply abort directly instead of potentially corrupting your memory and being exploited. So in practice, this is supported in package source with Linux since yesterday, and otherwise in NetBSD for a few months now, for GCC at least. Just like SSP, this is enabled with one line in make.conf. Package source use Fortify. There are different levels of protection. This will also use CFlags to carry a pre-processing macro, in this case, pre-processing value. And the different levels are detailed in the next slide, I believe. I do not remember exactly what the difference is between the two. But basically, if you enable it all the way up to 2, which is the highest level right now, some conforming programs, like programs which are actually written in legal C preprocessor, will actually fail. Maybe even fail to build. There are different challenges, since some programs may use macros to override sprintf, for instance, across the code base. This may conflict with the program. Another gotcha with Fortify is that it requires an optimization level of one or more for the compiler. And as of now, this is not enforced in package source. So it could be that you enable Fortify, and if the package does not use any optimization flags, it will not actually use Fortify. Of course, we can always add support also from our compilers and platforms, but for what's very important before that is to validate the results again. And as I mentioned, the compiler will change which calls are going to be issued, for instance, in the case of sprintf. And if you see a symbol sprintf check in your program using an M again, then it's a good sign that Fortify was actually used when compiling your program. This is also enabled by default in major distributions like Ubuntu Linux and Android. So I would also like to lobby for enabling this by default, at least on NetBSD for package source. Of course, a few packages will still break. I fixed a few, but there are more to fix. But this will give us a chance to see which ones are broken. And then it's always a trade-off. Do you prefer to fail open, fail safe? What is the safe case here? Is it better to crash? Or is it better to keep running even if there is a silent corruption? I don't know. I prefer to crash and see, discover what has to be fixed. Speaking of crashing, there is support for PAX ASLR in NetBSD. It's now enabled by default in NetBSD 8. It was a bit buggy up until 6, but now this is fixed. So this is now enabled in the incoming NetBSD 8 release, which was branched a couple weeks ago. So SLR, in a nutshell, is a mechanism to randomize the layout of program in memory. Your stack can be put at an arbitrary location, but if the program complies, also the code for the program can be placed in arbitrary locations. However, for this to work, it requires the code to be compiled position independent, PI, and this is not the default, neither in the base system of NetBSD or in the packages. It's a bit tricky to enable, to get it to work. However, it does make exploitation a lot more difficult, because then you no longer have fixed offsets as an attacker to target a running program. You need another bug, say a memory leak, to get to know where the memory is, or you need to use a return chain, and so on. Another trick with PI is that it involves not only the compilation phase, but also linking. And this is supported in package source for a few months now or so. So the compilation flag that this always sets is fpic. If you set this time package source and make PI in make.conf. However, I mentioned the linking phase, and you would hope that setting another LD flag would be enough, but unfortunately, it's not the case. So the reason is that this compilation flag, linking time, needs to be set for executables and not libraries. So it cannot be global. As a consequence, I had to implement this in the GCC wrapper for package source. And also now, since we switched to C wrappers, at least for NetBSD, I had to adapt C wrappers to support that. And my patch is currently being reviewed by Jörg, who's taking care of C wrappers. So another gotcha, which is minor, is that the real compilation flag should be fpi for executables instead of fpic. But it works anyway with fpic. It's good enough. And it's much more difficult to detect being the GCC wrapper if you're building a library on executable, than at linking time, where it's explicitly said so. So right now, we only use fpic globally when enabling PI. So there are issues with PI where some programs may fail to build, specifically if they do not handle C flags correctly, since here, regardless of supporting LD flags, we always set minus PI to enable PI support. If the program was not handling C flags, it will fail to link because it will not be built in position independent way. So actually, this is a great way to know which packages do not implement C flags as they should. So if a program fails to build with PI, it probably also doesn't support SSP, Fortify, and so on. Again, program may crash also at runtime with this feature, since they may make assumptions on the memory layout and so on. If you run SLR and PI, program may crash, or actually they will run in a different way slightly. So it can reveal silent bugs with this mechanism. And for those programs which always crash, we know a few in package source, specifically Firefox because of the just-in-time. However, this was now fixed, but this is still the case in Thunderbird. And a few other programs crash with mProtect and SLR. So we have introduced two mechanisms to specifically list which binaries need to be flagged for this. And then a package can be built directly setting the node in the ELF binary, in this case on NetBSD, to specifically disable either ASLR or mProtect when running. And then we can distribute packages with all of this enabled, at least globally for the whole tree, which will still run properly on the target system, even though they will be not as secure as they could be. So, of course, we need to validate that the program was compiled effectively as a PI executable. Thankfully, it's very easy thanks to file. It will let you know directly for F binaries, at least. Not explicitly, but if it says shared object on an executable, what you would expect for a library normally, then it means this was built with PI. Here I compiled two program, I mean, an identical program with or without Pi, and you can see the difference on this slide. Now, continuing with RelRho, which is the last security hardening feature we support right now in package source, at least from what I introduced. So RelRho was introduced at least in part by OpenBSD a few years ago. You can find some slides from Theo explaining how it works. I will just briefly summarize it here. So basically, it makes exploitation harder by reducing the attack surface through relocations. Normally, when you run a program, you have a relocation table, at least with ELF, where you can where the loader will update addresses so that the program knows where to find functions in different libraries or other parts of the program. And this was traditionally left read-write, so this meant that attackers could potentially use an arbitrary write to change an address over there and then gain execution privileges in a different place unintentionally, or intentionally for the attacker, of course. So this can be combined, this mechanism, RelRho, can be combined with something called bindNow, where the program will take care of every relocation as soon as it starts, and then map this page read-only, and then attackers can no longer bounce through these relocation tables. I hope I was clear enough, but this is not super critical to understand right now. What we need to know in our case is that there is a slight performance penalty when running big programs like LibreOffice, but this is not a big deal, at least on a modern system. And this involves the linking phase. In practice, this sets flags in the binary. This is done by using two flags, in the case of GCC, RelRho and now for the linker. In package source, this is enabled with use RelRho in make.conf. And again, of course, this requires the package to support LD flags, since this is a linking time parameter. In package source, we now support two different granularities, either full, which is RelRho and bindNow, or partial, which is just RelRho. And I noticed when working on the latest branch for HPST that some packages break at runtime with RelRho at the moment, and in particular Xorg, which is a problem if you use a laptop, for instance. So in my system here, I built Xorg with partial RelRho and the rest with full RelRho. Of course, again, RelRho can be adapted to more platforms since it's also supported on Linux and potentially more. I added the flag for Linux just yesterday. And if you want to check that a program was actually built with RelRho enabled, this time you're going to have to look at the ELF structure, namely the program header. You will find a new section called RelRho, where this operation takes place with the relocations. And bindNow will in turn set just a flag in the dynamic section. And if the dynamic loader sees this enabled, it will know if it supports it to perform every relocation right away and then stop there. I mean, map the page read only right away. So in HPST, I wrote a very small package to try to validate my settings, at least on the local system, when building packages. So this is simply called hardening in our small Git tree for package source. You add it just like WIP as another subdirectory of package source, and then you can build it as a package. And so once you build this package and you run the binary from it, it will use a library and from a main executable. So first the program will check if the library was built with FPIC, which otherwise wouldn't work on x86-64 actually. And then as an executable, it can know at runtime if it was built at compile time with FPIC and therefore supporting full ASLR. So here this was the case. It can also know, since it's a pre-processing macro, if Fortify source was enabled. So in this case, yes. And then I added one more check for write not execute in mmap. And there is one more thing in NetBSD that we can improve the last line to further harden the system. But this is not part of packet source. So now, except if there are other any other questions about the technical aspects, I would like to speak about what we can work on now to further harden packet source and be able to take advantage of this huge code base to test settings on the whole packet, I mean on the whole project at the same time, 17,000 packages. The first thing we could do, for instance, is to take care of building reproducibly. The definition of reproducible builds is a set of software development practices that create a verifiable path from human-readable source code to the binary code used by computers. So in practice, you need a deterministic build system where you can be sure you will always have the same result when building software given an environment. This means, for instance, that the timestamps need to be fixed, set to a specific time. The output needs to be ordered always in the same way. And to help with that, the reproducible builds project specified a file format to record parameters of the build environment and let people who want to reproduce a given binary to actually try to set up a similar environment and see that the binaries are identical to the ones that they received. This allows checking for backdoors. For instance, if you were not using signatures on an unsecure line, or if the attacker maybe has your private key. So in any case, this is implemented by FreeBSD in the ports. The initial patch was simply taking the timestamp from the distinfo file and then applying it to every file. This was already enough to cover about 60% of the packages of the ports for FreeBSD. A few more patches were required as well, but they've covered now most ports, as far as I know. There are many aspects of the build system that this impacts. One thing that's been standardized by the reproducible builds group is the source date epoch environment variable, which can then be used by build systems to as a reference timestamp. Also, GCC will potentially use different paths, pointing to different debugging symbols, depending also where it builds, it may embed this path in some places, but it supports remapping some of these paths at compile time, so you can make sure that your reference path is what's going to be used in the binary, even though you built in a different place. Very helpful. Then another thing that we can integrate in package source is code flow integrity. It prevents exploits from redirecting the execution flow of programs. So again, this triggers control crashes instead of running into running into fine behavior. And package source can be a great test bed for this feature. I think it's supported in Clang using two flags specifically, FLTO and FSanitize. Then there are many other options that different ways to use CFI from Clang. It can help also with debugging. And it was meant as something suitable for release builds. So the performance impact is actually very negligible. And so it's something that we could also enable for production packages. Would we build with Clang with package source? Then there is SafeStack, as Sean nicely pointed to me yesterday. I will not read all of that, but I can provide you a link to the definition of SafeStack, what it actually does. It involves C flags again, and very simply, you just enable this, and you get SafeStack enabled if all of the different pieces are in place. Then, just before concluding, GCC also supports additional security mechanisms. This one is, however, not intended for production. It's a memory error detector enabled with sanitized address. It can be very helpful when fuzzing, for instance. It will detect, it will instrument memory access to detect out-of-bound access in buffers and so on, and use after free bugs, for instance. So there is an impact here for regular binaries, but for fuzzing, this is great. So maybe not directly for package source, but we can think about ways to take advantage of package source to use this. So to conclude, PacketShorts is a great project for testing security features. I've been able to do all of this work, mostly adding just a few lines here and there to set specific flags. This can be used to test actually compilers and security measures on a wide range of software, regardless of the underlying platform. Very helpful. And thanks to this work, we can already enable, maybe even by default, some features from what I added in the past few months. So then I would like to thank BSD Cannes for the opportunity to be here and meet all of you guys. PacketSource for being an awesome way to distribute software. Joyent for helping me out with packet signatures and also providing long-term support on their branches. Some communities like Divius, HBSD, Hadron BSD, OpenBSD. You can reach me at NetBSD, of course, Corbin. And if you have any question and we still have time, then don't hesitate, please. Yeah?
Do you plan to have a check stack to make sure that something actually is trying to work around the fine parcels? You can imagine a package that at the top of the C files, they have hash and def.
Yeah. All right. So the question is, if could we insert a way in PacketShorts to detect directly if packages were built actually built with the measures in yeah. So it is completely possible to add support for that, at least for a few of these features. I even documented how to do it. It could be, for instance, part of the package developer flags for PacketShorts, which is a flag which already triggers additional checks, checking if every file from the plist was included and not more, checking for traces of paths from the compilation infrastructure in the final binary. So we could add additional checks for validating directly if the features were actually used when enabled. That's possible, yes. So I will consider this.
You mentioned the crash management control for the detects the upfront boundary, such kind of stuff. Have you evaluated the overhead to the performance?
So the question is about the overhead of the performance on the different mechanisms that are in place. So it depends on every mechanism, of course. If I go back to SSP, maybe, or the flag where I list all of them. So here, package signatures only impacts performance when installing the packages, because it has to verify cryptographically that the signature was valid. So at runtime, there is absolutely no impact. Then the binaries are installed as usual. With SSP, there is a minor impact. If you use the regular flag, just stack protector, it would be maybe around 1 to 3%. And with all, it would be maybe around 5%. Then it depends on the program itself, how many function calls it issues, and your hardware. With Fortify, the impact is really negligible, almost nothing, because it replaces a call to printf to a call with a buffer check, but it already knows what the buffer size is. It will just check the size as it copies the data over. In the case of Pi, I think there is only the impact of running position independent code, which is also minor usually. In the case of Railroad, it will be impacting the time it takes to spawn a process. So in the case of OpenOffice, maybe it's going to be half a second more. But actually, as a user myself, on my hardware, I do not notice it. I'm using OpenOffice here. Actually, I had a slide where I just said demo, because this is the demo. I'm running all of these mechanisms using OpenOffice for this presentation. So this is, yeah. This was built with all of the hardening features that I suggested in presentation, and it's OpenOffice 5, LibreOffice 5. I hope this answers your question. Yeah, great. Mm-hmm. anything else, then I can only thank you for your attention and hope to discuss that in the corridor track. All right.